worthy is the Lamb. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your grace.
Waymaker, miracle. to ask us this morning, why are we here? Why are we in church? Lord, we're here for you. I just see you, the Lord, walking among us this morning. To I just want to invite you to do something in a physical way. Just take in a deep breath and then just let it out. Holy Spirit, we receive you. We just breathe you in deeply this morning. We leave all of our stuff here at this place of communion, the blood of Jesus that covers everything. Now, Father, I ask in the name of your Son, Jesus, by the power of Holy Spirit, that you would show yourself as Waymaker this week in new ways that we don't even know how to ask or think or imagine, but we trust you, Lord, because you always keep your word.
Yes.
You are not a carrot dangling God, but you care and you love us, and you see clearly, even though we can't see clearly in the physical right now, you see clearly and you will lead us well. So, Lord, we thank you in your name. Amen. Good morning again. My name is Pastor Kerrie, and I'm one of the pastors here on staff. I'm just privileged to be here with all of us. This is awesome. And we have someone really fun that's going to share this morning. His name is Cal. I sort of introduced him a little bit earlier, but he's kind of done everything. I feel like you've kind of done every facet of like ministry at some point. He's led worship. He's helped plant churches. He has what they call para ministry, right? Para ministry, where he like comes alongside ministries and supports them and pastors. And so we can trust Cal because he hears from the Lord and he is carrying something for us this morning. So we're honored to have him. And God is doing really, really cool stuff. How many of you guys are having dreams? Is anyone having dreams or what they call night visions, where you're at night and you just start to see pictures, or during the day? Yeah, God is increasing that in my life too, and it's really fun. The Lord has had to just remind me this week not to get distracted with the stuff that's going on. There's a lot of stuff on social media. There's a lot of stuff in the news. Let's don't get distracted or discouraged by that. Let's keep our eye on what the Holy Spirit is doing, his protection, his clarity of heart and mind, and his direction. And so with that being said, I just want to welcome Cal and say thanks for being here this morning.
Thank you, Pastor Kerrie. Well, it's good to be here with you again. I love New Song. I've been here, I guess my third time speaking, and just excited about what God is doing here and just the transformation of what God is doing, not only in you as individuals, but what God is doing here in Lincoln. And what a great opportunity. There are plenty of lost people in the Lincoln area and people that need a relationship with Christ. And I'm just so excited to be a part in a small way. I mentioned last time I was here, New Song is an Assembly of God church. It's one of about 460 churches that we have in Northern California and Nevada district. So you have a lot of friends that are meeting all over Northern California and Nevada today. And like heart, like spirit, going through like experiences that you are. Be encouraged that you are not alone. And it's exciting what God is doing in each and every one of our individual lives. You know, when we think about it, Pastor Kerrie said, dreaming about dreams. The dreams I'm having right now, I'm converting my garage into a two-story tiny home for my daughter and granddaughter. So last night, all I dreamt about was putting up sheetrock. I doubt if that's the kind of dreams you were talking about. Yeah, that's right. Great being here with you today. And I'd like to share with you for just a few minutes of time about praying right. Seems like everything that's happened in this service today is kind of pointing toward doing things right and tearing down the barriers between us and God. So I'd like to share that with you today. The portion of scripture I'm looking at is Philippians 4:6. And in this portion of scripture, the Apostle Paul writes about how to pray in the right way. My son and I were working on a place months ago, and we were pulling carpet out. And as we're pulling carpet out, I don't know what the installer was thinking, but he went crazy with those staples in the pad. And, I mean, there were hundreds of staples that had nailed that carpet. It was not going anywhere. And we're pulling them out, and we got the, you know, the screwdriver and the thing, prying them out, popping them out. And, man, we worked for hours getting all the staples out. And at the end, my son looks up at me and says, "Dad, we did it the right way." You know what? There is always a right way and a wrong way to do things. There's always a shortcut. There's always a way that we can go end around and do it, but the end result isn't the same. And sometimes it's a learning curve to do things right. Sometimes it's a process that we have to grow into to be able to experience the right way to do things. And other times it's just about following the directions. And we look at this portion of Scripture as followers of Christ. God has given us the Bible so that we have the instructions. He's given us His Word so that when there's a question that goes on in our hearts or our spirits, that we can go to His Word, and it's going to be able to proclaim to us the right way to do things. And I believe this morning that many times we complicate God's will to a place that we think that we really have to work towards God's will, where in truth, God proclaims His will through His Word. And all we have to do is follow God, have a relationship with God, and there's going to be a walking in relationship with God that takes place in each and every one of our hearts. The Apostle Paul is a great one to talk about how to not have anxiety and have results that are positive in our prayers, because not only had he studied the Word of God, not only was he a student of the Old Testament, he was training to be a Pharisee, but he really went through the school of hard knocks. You look in the Scriptures and see all the things that he went through. Man, he got beat up with a lot of things that he was doing, but it brought him to the place where he could present to us some information and some guidance that is enriching, because it is very applicable, because he had tried and practiced it himself. Let's look at Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. The Apostle Paul writes, "Don't worry about anything, but instead pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done." Now, we look at that portion of Scripture today, and especially in this culture and these times that we're living in today, there are obviously things that we worry about. There's obviously things that seem to come between us and become blockades for us to actually have that free relationship with God that we want, because there's always these things on the verge of our consciousness that kind of try to detract us off of where God wants us to be. But Paul uses three words in this portion of Scripture to describe right praying, and I'd like to share those with you this morning if you're taking notes. First word that Paul shares is the word prayer. And he says, next slide, "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything." Now, that sounds pretty simplistic, doesn't it? Don't worry about anything, but instead pray about everything. Now, you know what? It's easy for Paul to tell us not to worry. COVID wasn't taking place when Paul was around. There aren't fires all over the place that are lending towards smoke. I thought we had bad air yesterday. Up above, I live up above Auburn, up in the woods, and we were at about 293 was the air quality. And we got on this morning and looked at Reno. Reno's at 413, so let's just thank God we're not in Reno today. But the thing is that those are things to worry about. You know, you don't know whether to wear your mask because of COVID or wear your mask. I sent a text out to some of my friends in Texas the other day, and I said, "I don't know whether I'm wearing my mask because of the sheetrock dust, or COVID, or because of the smoke." I mean, you know, it's a whole different world than it was 6-8 months ago. But really, as we look at the whole arena of where we are, we need to understand that we all worry about something at one time or another. We worry about our jobs, our money, our health, our families. But notice the transition word here is instead. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Now, I don't know who has a clicker that figures these things out, but I read the other day that they have proven that 85% of the things we worry about never happen. 85% of the things that we are staring at the ceiling at in the middle of the night worrying about are never going to come true. 85% of the things that we form blockades with of why we can't do things will never really become apparent in our lives. So we look at this transition that the Apostle Paul puts here, and he says, instead of worrying about things, instead we need to move into a place where we pray about everything. Prayer is about our relationship with God. Prayer is a conversation with God. In fact, there is an old pastor named Smith Wigglesworth that was around back in the 1800s, and he said, God does nothing except in response to prayer. Now think about that. God does nothing except in response to prayer. If that's really true, and it's proven out in the Bible, if that's really true, then it means that if we don't pray about stuff, that there isn't anything that's going to happen. Things just don't kind of fall into place, but God's hand is moved when his people that are in relationship with him begin to pray and to begin to seek God and begin to believe that God is the way maker. I'm going to keep on talking about that song this morning. And that God is the one that is going to make the way, that God is the one that's going to break down the walls, that God is the one that's going to be able to perform the miracle in your heart and your life. You know, really, this prayer and this communication carries with it the idea of adoration, devotion, and worship. And let's look at these words really quick. The definition, adoration means respect, reverence, strong admiration, or devotion. We think about the maybe people or things in our lives where we give respect, reverence, strong admiration, or devotion. God especially needs our adoration. Another word that is used when we look at the next slide here is devotion. Devotion, the definition is love, loyalty, or enthusiasm. Think about the things that you're devoted to today. Think about the things that you get excited about today. Really, when we pray, what is happening is that we are giving God devotion and we are giving him our love. We are giving him our loyalty. We are giving him our enthusiasm with all of our strength that we have relationship with him. And then the third word that is talked about here is worship. It's feeling or expression of reverence and adoration. There is a reverence that we give to God because he is king of the world. There is a reverence. A couple days ago during my prayer time, man, it was just so sweet because I began to think about, God, you are the ruler of the universe, but you love me. You're the ruler of the universe and you care about everything that happens in my life. The king of all of the universe cares about you today. And when we talk about giving him our adoration, our devotion, our worship, it should be just an automatic process because of understanding who God is. The Apostle Paul writes here that whenever we find ourselves anxious, whenever we find ourselves worrying, that we need to take time to get alone with God and to just worship him for who he is. And when we feel anxiety and worry creeping up on us, we just need to open our hearts to God. When our hearts can embrace the magnitude and the greatness of God, then we can realize that he's big enough for our situation. Then we can realize that he is able to intervene on our behalf. Then we can realize all over again that God is the one that is in control of everything. He's big enough for our situation. So is everything just about when we're broke? You know, this portion of scripture, is it you're talking about praying about everything? Is it just when maybe we don't feel good, or maybe we don't have enough money in our checking account, or maybe we're having problems in our family or relationships? No, the scriptures say instead we need to pray about everything. Everything. That means when we're driving down the road. There was a guy I was driving down 80 today. This red Mustang, I see him just flying up on me. That wasn't you, was it? Flying up on me from behind me. And he cuts into my lane and drives on the shoulder, and then cuts all the way across three lanes and keeps on going. And I'm like, oh my goodness. You know, the automatic thing is to honk and flash your brights at him. And instead, I begin to pray for him. And you know what? Instead of worrying about things, instead of allowing those negative things to impact us negatively, instead we pray and put it back in God's hands. The second word that Paul uses in this portion of scripture is petitions. And that's the definition here, because it says, tell God, next slide please, tell God what you need. That's basically giving God our petitions. This is where we bring our requests to God. Now, I have a 5-year-old granddaughter. In fact, I think I have her picture on my slide. There she is. 5-year-old granddaughter. She's going to be 6 on Saturday. I am in Barbie world right now. In fact, when I leave here today, I have found Barbie clothes in Auburn on Facebook Marketplace that I'm picking up a pack of Barbie clothes for her. And we've gone out, and I've got her a little Barbie car. And my daughter laid out all the stuff on our table that she's getting. And there isn't anything that doesn't say Barbie on it. And, you know, and when you sit down and play with her, she hands you a Barbie and tells you what clothes to put on Barbie. So if you can imagine, just close your eyes and imagine me dressing Barbies for hours at a time. That's my world right now. And she always tells us how to do things. She always, if you have grandkids, how many have grandkids here? This, oh, I'm among friends. She always tells what she needs. She wants water, she wants food, or she wants Poppy to, you know, sit down and just stay there and watch her play Barbies. And she verbalizes it very concisely. Think about what I mentioned before. God does nothing except in response to prayer. God desires for his people, his children, to verbalize what we need from God. And God, as a loving heavenly father that loves us with a never-ending, never being able to calculate love that is greater than anything we can understand, is willing to do whatever it takes to bring us to the place where we need to be, to bring us to a place where we're blessed, to bring us to a place where our needs are met. His word says he supplies all of our needs according to his riches and glory. So really, in the same way, we need to let God know what we need. When we're in the midst of anxiety or worry, we just need to blurt it out. We need to tell God how we feel. God, I'm frustrated. I did that last night. God, I am frustrated about this smoke. I feel like I'm getting claustrophobic. You know, I'm frustrated about COVID. I'm frustrated. Thank God the heat's gone. It's going to be in the 70s this week. But God, you know what? The world has changed so much since the beginning of March. I'm frustrated about where we are right now. But you know what? God is not frustrated. God is not confused. God is not disillusioned, because he has always known that we'd be sitting in this room today, social distance. He knew that I'd be sharing this morning and Pastor Lane would be recipients of our prayers. He knew everything about today because he loves us so much. So we need to tell God how we feel. We need to ask him to help. And the truth is, the scriptures say God already knows what our needs are. Matthew chapter 6, verse 7 and 8 says, when you pray, don't babble on as the Gentiles do. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again and again. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need before you ever ask him. Amen. Think about that. The things that are in your mind, the things that are in your spirit, the things that are that you're experiencing right now, God knows everything. And because he's omniscient and knows everything, he's waiting for us to request that he would come alongside us and help us. And when we open up our hearts and we open up our mouths and we verbalize how we feel to God, God has promised that he is always there. In fact, there's a portion of scripture that says why those words are even now coming out of our mouth, that his angels are being sent out to answer our needs at the exact moment that those words come out of our mouth. You know what? That's our loving Heavenly Father. That's the same way you treat your grandkids and your children. It's the way that God treats us, but we have to verbalize what we need so that God can move into that. We need to practice giving our needs to God in prayer. And then my last point that's here this morning is about praises. It says in that portion of scripture in Philippians, thank God for all he has done. This is where we show appreciation for what God has done in our lives. Because God, like everybody else, including all of us that are in this room, like it when people say thank you. We like it when people approach us and say, you know what? Thank you so much. That was so great. I just can't believe you opened up your heart and did that. And really, in a world that we're living in today, for some reason, people have gotten into a mentality where they don't say thanks anymore. Those of you that are grandparents, you probably have experienced your grandkids not saying thank you for maybe a birthday gift. Some of you are shaking your heads. You know where I'm going with this. You know, or something that you've gone out of the way to do for them. You know what? It's the same way with God. I had a friend of mine that put up on Facebook. In fact, go ahead and bring that. I think I had that slide up. She says, I'm curious to know how many of you have given wedding, graduation, etc. gifts lately and have not received thank you notes. Does this younger generation believe they are entitled to receive and not give thanks? I've experienced this 3 times in the last few months. I guess they're just too busy. I wonder if God looks down upon us, his children, and says, I guess they're just too busy. I wonder if God, if he had a Facebook site, would put something like this up on Facebook. Because you know that's what he's feeling inside of his heart. In fact, in the Old Testament, it said that God is jealous for his people's praises. God wants worship. He wants praise. He wants adoration. He wants relationship. And many times we get so up and entangled in our worry and our anxiety that we do not have the ability or the bandwidth to be able to reach out to God and just say, God, thank you. Thank you for who you are. God, we praise you. We worship you. The scriptures say, actually, that God moves into our praises. And as he moves into our praises, in fact, the scripture, Psalms chapter 22 and verse 3 says, you are enthroned in the praises of Israel. And another version, the one version we've mostly heard, is God inhabits the praises of his people. The thing that goes through my mind when I praise and when I worship God is that God physically is moving into that place, which is my heart, when I open up and begin to praise him. When I thank him, when I praise him, when I worship him, there is something spiritual that takes place inside of his people because it is God taking up residence inside of us because it's kind of like cleaning the house for company. You know what? We've got it all dialed in. We've got everything put away. We're focused on the fact that we're getting ready for God, and that's what praise and worship does. Thank you for praise and worship. I'm so impressed. I'm sitting there going, where have you been? What a great gift you have. Bless you. You guys are a blessed congregation here this morning. But you've got to love the fact that God moves into our praises. You've got to love the fact that God loves us so much that he's just waiting on the portals of heaven for us to just open up the door and say, God, thank you. God, praise you. So that God can flood in with everything that he is and everything that he has. When we praise God and thank him for what he's done, he responds by moving into that time of praise and thanks with his presence. And if you've ever experienced this, you know exactly what I'm talking about because there is nothing like it when God shows up. And this is what happens when we express thanks. You know, when we take time to worship God, we then present a request, follow up with thankfulness and praise, we follow the pattern that the Apostle Paul has laid out for us and experience a transformation in our spirits. Now, don't miss this. There is a transformation and change that takes place in our spirits when we follow the formula that the Apostle Paul gives us here for how to pray. When we follow these steps in prayer, God moves into our lives, and anxiety and worry not only needs to leave, but it has to leave. Check out how Paul wraps up this thought in Philippians 4:7. He says, then, after you've done these things, you will experience God's peace. Whose peace is it? God's peace. It's not our peace because of something that we figured out or something that we've gone through a thought process and all of a sudden we've arrived at, oh, wow, I figured this out. But instead, when you then you will experience God's peace when you pray right and allow God to be able to be the one that is moving into your heart and spirit, which exceeds anything we can understand. And his peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Notice what takes place. You experience God's peace. If you're here this morning and you aren't experiencing God's peace, if there is turmoil, if there is anxiety and worry, you know, I dare say that every one of us have experienced those feelings at least one time this week. Maybe even one time today. Maybe even 40 times during the service. Because that's just the way it is. And I'll share with you right now that worry and anxiety is not from God. Worry and anxiety becomes a blockade because it brings our focus off of God and puts it on us and our own circumstances. But thank God we can experience God's peace greater than anything we've ever can understand. And his peace then, once we get that door open, will begin to guard our hearts and our minds as we live in Christ Jesus. And God, that's what we need today. That's what we need today. My prayer this morning is for everyone that is within the sound of my voice, that we would even right now look toward you. We intentionally today set aside worry and anxiety because you are in control of the universe. We right now, Father, begin to even voice out. And if there's something, just sense this morning, if there's something that has been on the fringe of your consciousness all during this service today that you need to give God, do it right now. God, we give you that thing right now. If it's sickness, if it's finances, if it's all the commotion that's taken place in our world today, Father, we set that aside and give that to you right now. And God, we praise you and thank you that you are faithful, not only to hear our prayers, not only to know who we are, but Father, I pray as we thank you right now out of our hearts that you're flooding in with presence and with peace like we've never experienced before. And Father, that there is a powerful thing of your spirit that has taken place today. Father, powerful thing of relationship that is happening right now in the midst of this prayer. A powerful work of your Holy Spirit that is encompassing us right now. And Father, if it's any of those areas we've talked about today, we give those things to you. And instead, we walk out of this room with your peace in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. All right, we're going to you know, we're just going to worship for a minute, actually. Let's just say Jesus. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise. one more time, and then we're going to take offering.
Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Say your great name, your great name. One more time, your great name.
So Lord, we just thank you this morning for your word. We thank you this morning that you're faithful. We thank you, Jesus, that you hear every prayer, like the Jonah prayer of help to the very more sophisticated prayers. And we thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Lord. We want to be transformed by you, Holy Spirit. Can you just do something with me this morning? Can you just repeat after me? And say, Jesus, I want to be transformed by Holy Spirit in every area of my life. And I thank you. Now you fill in the blank in your heart there. In the name of Jesus, who we believe and trust. Amen. So, we're just going to worship for a little while more, but you're totally dismissed. One of the awkward parts about being the worship pastor and also the MC is that you go, you can be dismissed. I'm going to just hang out here and worship for a minute. So, whenever you want to go, it's fine. We're not offended. But we're just going to sing this song again. I feel like the Holy Spirit just so wanted us to sing this out into the atmosphere.
Lost or saved, find their way.
Yes, God. Yes, God. At the sound
of your great name.
All condemned, feel no shame.
All condemned. Feel no shame
at the sound
of your great name.
Every fear has no place.
Every fear
has no place.
At the sound of your great name.
The enemy has to leave.
The enemy, he has to leave. We have the sound of your grace. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. The Son.
At the sound
of your great.
Hungry souls receive grace.
Hungry souls receive grace.
At the sound
of your great.
The fatherless find their rest.
The fatherless. They find their rest at the sound of your great.
The sick are healed, the dead are raised.
The dead are raised.
Your